Good evening all. So today I think I will talk about history of complex numbers. This talk is actually based on a small essay written by Orlando Merino, A Short History of Complex Number, which you can search in Google and then get it. So I just use this presentation, his write-up for this presentation. And if you want to know more about history of complex number, there is a very good book by Naheen, and you can even download it and then read it. So that is the starting. You know, this is not anything original, so it is all available on the internet. So let us see the story. People usually say, you know, many things are stories only, not the real fact. So here are some stories that we know of complex number. Even when I was writing a book, I was saying that when you want to solve equation like 2x equal to 3, then we need rational numbers. When we solve x squared equal to 2, then we need irrational numbers. And then when you want to solve x square plus 1 equal to 0, then we need a complex number. So when you are writing the formula for the quadratic equation, you know, the solution of quadratic equation, we have the discriminant b square minus 4ac that comes under the square root sign. So when it comes under the square root sign, if the discriminant is negative, then you will get a complex number. So people say that when you want to solve quadratic equation, you need complex number. That is why it is introduced. But that is not the real story. When the quadratic equation has no real solution, people ignore. That's all. They never try to solve it. So the complex number came only when they tried to solve the cubic equation. What is the reason? The reason is very simple. We know that if you have a cubic equation with a real coefficient, then at least one real root is there. So, but then when you derive a formula for a cubic equation, that formula looks like the formula for quadratic equation, but then there will be some problem that comes. So we will see all the story now. So before that, some more history. So the algebra, you know, went from India to Arabian countries. That is the story. So Al-Khwarizmi, this is a guy who wrote a book on algebra also. This story all goes, you know, from the Greek and Hindu mathematics only. So and this guy was a member of House of Wisdom. House of Wisdom. And there is so many things about it, but let us not worry too much about it. But you can see all this story in the article that I mentioned. So before that, I think it is also, you know, this once the Al-Khwarizmi wrote a book, and then, you know, this was translated into other languages. And then the Fibonacci also used it later. And then this Fibonacci was introduced to the king, Frederick II. And when he was introduced to the king, and then there was a local mathematician, and he posed several problems. And this Fibonacci can solve all these problems. One of the problems that, you know, that was posed by this local mathematician is this equation. Solve this equation, x cubed plus 2x squared plus 10x equal to 20. Those old days, people usually have equation with all positive coefficient. X is also positive, the coefficients are positive, so they never used negative numbers. So that I think we should remember. That is why this equation is given with all positive coefficients. So they have rewritten that equation like x cubed plus 2x squared plus 10x equal to 20, so that they don't need to use minus 20. This is the kind of things that we may see in the coming slides also. So in those old days when there is not many universities and not many textbooks, how do you attract people to your university? You know, that is the interesting thing. So people will come to an university if the professor there is a very, very good expert. How do you prove expertise? Nowadays, you people go to the conferences and present papers, or you publish in a reputed journal, then the institute reputation grows. In those old days, it was all by calling somebody for a mathematical contest. So you will pose problem, and then whether the other guy could solve it or not, that is the thing. So if the other guy can solve it, then he will win and his reputation goes up. And if he cannot solve it, then his reputation will go away. So that is the kind of thing, and this is the situation here also. So when this Fibonacci was introduced to the king, then the local mathematician posed question to Leonardo so that they can say that this guy don't know anything. But Leonardo solved all these things. That is the story. So this story will be continuing. So we are going to say some such story later also. But before that, let us see this particular equation. This is the cubic equation. We normally write ax cube plus bx square plus cx plus d equal to 0, but I can divide by the leading coefficient and then we can write it in this particular form. This is very easy, useful also, because definitely this is of degree 3. If a is there in front of x, then if a is 0, then that may become quadratic or linear or simply a constant. But that is eliminated here by dividing and normalizing it like this. So when you want to solve this equation, then if you see many of the textbook on theory of equation, you will see that this equation is converted to a simpler form wherein the x square term will be missing. That you can easily do it by putting y equal to x plus a by 3 and then rewrite the equation in x into an equation in y. And I think this is easy calculation. You can try that. So if you write y equal to x plus a by 3, that original equation in x can be converted to the equation y cube plus py plus q equal to 0, where p and q are related to a, b, c in some particular way. So this method is already known in the 14th century. There was some manuscript in a European country, a place called Florence, and there some manuscripts are there, and in that manuscript these are all available. So when you are thinking of this equation y cube plus py plus q equal to 0, and if you want to allow only positive integers for p, q and y, then there are three possible ways of writing the equation. You can either write it as x cube plus px equal to q, where p, q, x are all positive, or else you can write it in this way or in this other way. So you have a possibility of writing the equation y cube plus py plus q equal to 0 in these three possible ways when p, q are assumed to be only positive. So these are all called depressed cubic. Depressed because the x square term is removed from this. And we are going to show you the solution of the first two of them in our lecture today. Our story really begins with Del Ferro and Tartaglia, who is this guy, and then the Cardano. Cardano is this guy. So the story for some more time, this will be going around them. The Del Ferro is the one who really found out the formula for the solution of the cubic equation. And later, Tartaglia found the formula himself. And then this guy, Cardano, published the formula in a book by him. So that is how this formula is known as Cardano formula. So Cardano formula is not something that is invented by Cardano first. It was invented by Del Ferro. Okay. So many theorems are in the name of some other person. The original person may not have been named there. For example, the similar thing is there with our theorem in algebra. What is that theorem? That is called order of H subgroup divides order of G, Lagrange theorem. This Lagrange theorem says that order of a subgroup of a finite group divides the order of the original group. If you remember, Lagrange died long before group theory was invented. So group theory term itself is not known to Lagrange. But then the theorem is called the Lagrange theorem because Lagrange proved a very special case of the so-called theorem long back. So that was generalized to group theory by somebody, and then that theorem is known by Lagrange theorem. So there are similar situation also. L-Hospital rule also something similar. Yes, L-Hospital rule is known to somebody else, that L-Hospital learnt it from some mathematician. I don't recall the name. And then he wrote a book, and then where he used it, and therefore it is called L-Hospital rule. Anyway, that is a story. So the equation, you know, the depressed cubic, this is solved by this Del Ferro. He was a professor until 1526 and he died at that time. So the formula was known for a long, long time. So what happened is the formulas are usually kept secret. They don't say the formula to anyone, because as long as you know some formula and nobody else know, then you can frame a question based on that formula and pose it to the other mathematician and you can challenge them. When they cannot solve it, then your reputation grows. So people usually keep the formula very secret. And that is what happened with this formula for the cubic equation also. So he never told the formula to anybody, and while he was about to die, then he told this formula to his student, Antonio Maria Fiori. So he told this formula to him, and then what happened is the student challenged Tartaglia for a mathematical contest. So he said, okay, you come, I am challenging you. So Fiori challenged Tartaglia, and then Tartaglia thought, how can this guy, you know, challenge me like this? That means you know the formula for cubic equation. Otherwise, he may not be calling me for the contest. So, having known that there is some formula, Tartaglia could derive the formula on his own. So he derived the formula without knowing the formula that Del Ferro told to the Maria Fiori. So, he derived the formula on his own, and then he won the contest. So that is how Tartaglia's reputation is now there. So Tartaglia then, you know, told the formula to the Cardano. He never gave the proof, but he gave the formula to Cardano later. And with the agreement that he will never reveal it to anybody else. So that was the story. So Tartaglia told the formula to Cardano. But later what happened is he could reconstruct the proof. Once you know the formula, you know how to derive it. So he derived the formula on his own. At least he gave a proof of the formula. And then he learned that Del Ferro had the formula, and he verified it by going to the relatives of this guy and then, you know, see the papers that Del Ferro wrote. So he verified that it is actually Del Ferro had the formula first, and then because of this competition, then Tartaglia derived it on his own. So he found out all this, and then he published the formula for all the three cases of the depressed cubic in his book Ars Magna. That was published in 1545. Okay, Del Ferro by the time died also. He died in 1526, and Cardano published his formula in 1545. And he also mentioned that Del Ferro as the first author of this formula, and Tartaglia as obtaining the formula later in an independent manner. So that he mentioned very clearly how this formula was derived, who derived it first, and then all that story he mentioned it in the book. So let us see quickly that how this guy, you know, Del Ferro derived the formula. What he did is to write the solution x as u plus v. That is an interesting fact. Nobody might have thought that you can write the x is u plus v, and then get the answer from there. So there is a trick. We will see what is the trick then. So he wrote x equal to u plus v and then put it in the depressed cubic. He substituted x equal to u plus v in the depressed cubic. So it will become x cube plus bx will become u cube plus v cube plus 3 times uv times u plus v. This is the x u plus v, the whole cube is written like this. And then p times u plus v will come, and this is equal to q. This is the equation that we have to solve now. So from this particular equation, we have to solve for u and v and get it. And if you combine these terms here, 3uv plus p times u plus v will come. If you can choose the uv in such a way that 3uv plus p is 0, if you choose this way, 3uv plus p is 0, then this equation will become u cube plus v cube equal to q. And then from this, you will get that u cube plus v cube equal to minus p cube by 27. So you'll be just getting these two equations by writing x equal to u plus v and setting 3uv plus p equal to 0. Anyway, u and v are not known, so you can always constrain that u and v satisfy this particular condition, 3uv plus p equal to 0. That is the idea. So writing x equal to u plus v and then constrain them by putting 3 times uv plus p equal to 0 is the key idea. It is very difficult to guess how he got the idea, but he got the idea. That is why he is still there in the literature. So once you have this, what you can do is you can find what is u cube and v cube. Because if you think u cube and v cube as two quantities, then we know that the sum is known, product is known. Once sum of two quantities and product of two quantities is known, then we can get the quantities by putting as the quadratic equation. So you think that u cube and v cube are root of a quadratic equation, then you can form the quadratic equation, solve it, and then you will get u cube and v cube. Once you know u cube and v cube, then you can get u and v. So you just solve the quadratic equation whose roots are u cube and v cube by forming the quadratic equation whose sum is q, the product is this. Then by the quadratic formula, then you will be getting this as the one possible root of this equation involving u. You will be having two values, but you get a positive square root you take, and then you will be getting this expression for u. This is just solving the quadratic equation. And then you write what is u, u will be the cube root of the result. Similarly, v. So the only difference between u and v is there is a minus sign here, there is a plus sign here. So you put it in that, then you will get the formula for x. It is very easy derivation. You can try this. When our equation itself is x cube plus px equal to q, p and q are positive. Once p and q are positive, the quantity inside the square root is a positive quantity. Therefore, the square root doesn't cause any problem. Okay, because both p and q are positive, therefore the quantity inside the square root is a positive quantity. Square root, you can compute always. There is no imaginary quantity coming in picture. So this q by 2 is also positive, then therefore the positive number is there and you have to find cube root. That is perfectly all right. Here you may get a negative quantity, but taking cube root of a negative quantity is not a problem, because cube root of minus a cube will be minus a. So you can easily take the cube root of this quantity even if the quantity here is a negative quantity. So this formula doesn't pose any problem when you want to find out the real root of the cubic equation. So other combination may give the other roots, but this real root can be given by this expression. And there is absolutely no problem when you write the depressed cubic in the form of x cube plus px equal to q. The answer is coming here. You recall that a cubic equation has at least one real root. And I am going to do the same calculation for the other depressed cubic. Suppose you are having the depressed cubic like x cube equal to px plus q. Then let us see what will be the answer. There is nothing really great in these two things. See, what we have done is we have taken this px to the other side, and then it will go as minus px, but instead of minus px we have written as px. So that means whatever formula that we have derived, if you replace the p by minus p, then you will get the answer. But if you want to derive the equation in the same way, then you can do that. the same calculation will lead to the same formula. You can see that the only difference between the two formula is now here a minus sign comes. In the earlier formula, it was plus. Here, it is now minus because we are replacing the p by minus p. So, this is a formula for the solution of this depressed cubic, x cube equal to px plus q. But then let us see what is the problem here. The problem here is if q square minus 4 is a smaller quantity than this quantity, p cube by 27, then this quantity will become negative. So once it is becoming negative, then in the today's terminology, the square root of this one will give you a complex number, I times something. So this will become a complex number, and then we have something like a plus ib here. So then we are taking cube root of a plus ib. Here we have cube root of a minus ib. And one of the combinations should give you the real root, because this equation has at least one real root. Every cubic equation has one real root. So this combination, cube root of a plus ib plus cube root of a minus ib, is supposed to give you a real root. A complex number is coming here, but then your answer is supposed to be real. That is where the trouble came. So that is where the need for understanding complex number came, because you have a real root, but this formula is not given in terms of the real numbers. There is a complex number coming in picture. That is the starting point for our complex number business. So, okay. So here the square root, the quantity inside the square root may be negative. That causes the problem. So Cardano avoided discussing about this particular situation in his book Ars Magna. Okay, he has not discussed about it. He just avoided it. He thought in this case there may be no real root. So at that time they may not be knowing that there may be a real root for cubic equation. So he avoided discussing this case. Probably he assumed that there may be no real root in that case. And this Cardano was the first one to introduce the complex number a plus square root of minus b, but he is not used it properly, and he has also given a problem that to divide 10 into two parts, the product of which is 40. So this will lead to complex number solution only. The solutions are like 5 plus root of minus 15 and 5 minus root of minus 15. If you multiply these in the today's world, I think there is nothing great. If you multiply these two complex numbers, you will get 40. So he wrote all these in his book, but he mentioned that this is a, you know, this is a mental torture for him. So he never understood what is the dynamics. So he was saying that it is a mental torture. So the story continues. It is Bombelli who came later. He wrote set of three books, and he is the one who introduced this notation for square root of minus 1. So he is the person, he formally introduced the square root of minus 1. And the Bombelli's book also continues the discussion in the line of Cardano, but now he has discussed the negative case also. That means when the quantity inside the square root is negative, then complex number came. That also was discussed in that book. So it is all done by Bombelli, but this is a book of Cardano. Cardano has written a book, that is what we were mentioning. This is the book by Cardano. Those old days, the books are printed like this. I think this colored one is a recent edition, maybe the translated one. This is not the English version, but an English version is now available. Probably if you want to, you can look at it. Most of the old books can be obtained from internet easily, because they are all posting it in the internet on various sites. One such place will be our archive.org. So he, Bombelli, considered this equation. You know, in his book, he considered that x cube plus 50 equal to 15x plus 4. And the Cardano formula gives you this as the answer. Okay, in this case, the Cardano formula gives you x is cube root of 2 plus square root of minus 121. So this is what is given by the Cardano formula. So, but then, can you guess the root for this equation, that x cube plus x cube equal to 15x plus 4? X equal to 4 satisfies this equation. So when you are putting x equal to 4, this equation is satisfied. Therefore, x equal to 4 is a solution. Then this will be reducing to 4 in some way. That is where the discussion came. So what he did is, Bambali did is to write the cube root of 2 plus square root of minus 121 as a plus ib. And then squared, cubed it, and then found out what is the real part, imaginary part kind of thing. And then he also shown that other quantity is actually a minus ib. Once it is shown that a minus ib, then when you add it, you will get 2a, that is 4, because a is 2. Not a is 2, yeah, he got that a is 2 by manipulating all this. So he was able to show that this is actually equal to 4 by using complex number, some manipulation of complex number. Once he wanted to manipulate all this complex number, then, you know, the complex number was born. So it is this Bambali's book that is responsible for this. So he is Bambali and it is his book. Okay. The year is also written in Roman. Okay. So he also thought that all these use of complex number is like a fallacious argument, but then he could prove it, so it is continued. And then, you know, the Cartesian coordinate system and all that, this came from the work of René Descartes. He also did something on this complex number business. So he has given imaginary number in with a geometric impossibility. So he did many things with the geometry. So the imaginary numbers and the term imaginary was coined by Descartes. It does not go into much detail, even difficult to read his book title. Again, there is stories, but anyway, let me skip these things. John Wallis also has contributed. And for him, you know, when initially when people started using number system, integer were there. But then they started thinking about positive real numbers, because when you draw a line and then if you measure length, and then any positive real number will come. When zero was introduced, and then you place zero somewhere on the line, anything to the right side will be positive real number, anything to the left will be negative real number. So there is no problem in accepting negative real numbers as something that they can imagine. Such thing was given for complex number by Wallis. That is what he has tried. So here is the book by Wallis on algebra. This is a guy. De Maurier also had some connection with complex number. I think you know what is the connection. So the connection is that when he was very young, 18 years of age, he went to London, and then he became friend with Newton. So they are at the same time, contemporary. And then this, you know, in 1698, he mentioned that De Maurier mentioned that Newton knew the formula, what we now call De Maurier's theorem, cos theta plus I sin theta power n equal to cos n theta plus I sin n theta. This formula is known to Newton also. So Newton knows this formula and used it for some other purpose. So he used it for finding the cube root. Yeah, because whenever you want to find the square root or cube root, I think you just write that complex number in the argument polar form, you know, the modulus argument form. You write the complex number as z equal to r e power I theta, then you can find any powers of z very easily. You just write z power n equal to r power n e power I n theta. So, and then use this De Maurier theorem to compute what is the real and imaginary part. So he used this formula for finding the cube root that appeared in the Cardano's formula. So De Maurier also, you know this formula, but he has not used it explicitly. But that is another story. This is the guy, De Maurier. So the symbol I was introduced by Euler. So Euler 1707 to 1783. This Euler only introduced the symbol I equal to square root of minus 1, and he visualized a complex number in the way we are visualizing now as an element in our complex plane. But he also not gave a very satisfactory foundation of complex number, but Euler did many other things with the complex numbers. Let me say something more about Euler in a moment, but Euler used this representation of complex number, you know, x plus iy equal to r times cos theta plus I sin theta is the formula used by Euler. And he also solved that equation z power n equal to 1 and shown that these are the vertices of a regular polygon. I think any complex analysis book will contain this particular thing. The nth root of unity will be vertices of a regular polygon of n sides. He also defined exponential function, the complex exponential, and proved that e power I theta is cos theta plus I sin theta. You have to just use the power series expansion for cos, sin, sin, and then e power x. And then you will get this. I don't know how clear this picture is, but this picture I think will indicate that Euler is, you know, a blind person. It doesn't look so, but one of the eyes, you know, looks very closed somewhat. This picture is not that clear, but doesn't matter. He was blind for about 17 years of his life, you know. He was blind for 17 years. Last 17 years, he was a blind person, and then he wrote a lot of, you know, research paper during that period by dictating to the assistant. So the assistant wrote it by dictation, and he did all his research in fluid dynamics like area at that time. So he can visualize everything in mind, and then, you know, he dictated things to the assistant. Assistant wrote. If you want to know how many large volumes are required to print his collected works, it was about 100 large volumes. Okay, almost everything in mathematics is written by Euler. That is why many theorems are not known by Euler name. It is known by other names. Okay, even the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality is something from Euler, I guess. Okay, then the story continues. It is Wessel, a Norwegian mathematician. He presented a geometric representation of our complex number. You know, those old days when you want to publish a paper in a particular journal, you should become a member of that academy. Only members can publish a paper in a journal published by the academy. I think this continues even today when you go for publishing in IEEE transaction. They usually say, you know, author name, and then they will say member. If you are not a member, they may not say that. So you had to be a member, and this paper by Wessel was published even though he was not a member of the academy. So people understood the importance of it, and that goes. But his approach was that of vectors. So he introduced complex number as vectors, and he did everything using that vector concept. Anyway, this I think everybody knows that Argand is a Persian bookkeeper. Nobody knows whether he had a mathematical training, but he wrote an essay and printed it in a private press and circulated. So the essay is titled "The Essay on Geometrical Interpretation of Imaginary Quantities." He just printed the content. He never printed the name on the manuscript, so it went without a name, and this copy ended with the legendary. And then he sent it to Francis, a professor of mathematics somewhere. And then when this guy died, and these papers are all went to his brother, and he was a professor of military art and a mathematician. So what he did is he found out the legendary's letter describing the Argand's mathematical result. And he published it in an article in 1813 in the Annals de Mathematics, giving the basics of complex number. And in the last para of the paper, he mentioned that it all came to him through the legendary's letter, and asked the author to come forward to identify himself. And then this somehow reached Argand also, and then Argand wrote to them, and then this reply also appeared in the journal's next issue. That is the story. And here is almost end of the story now. So the origin of complex number, today we, any complex analysis book says that a complex number is an ordered pair. This ordered pair notation of a complex number was found by Hamilton. So this was done in 1831, and he defined ordered pairs, and then addition and multiplications are defined in the usual way that we know of. So this is algebraic definition of complex number. So Hamilton is the one in the first picture. The other one is a Gauss. So Gauss also had a contribution to complex number. He has given Gauss has been in possession of the geometric representation of complex number since 1796, but he published only in 1831. That is the long story then. So he introduced that term. Gauss introduced the term complex number. Okay, that is what the contribution of Gauss here. Okay. So you can see that last line. In 1811 itself, in letter to Bessel, Gauss mentioned the theorem that was to be known later as Cauchy theorem. So Cauchy theorem is not really the one found by Cauchy for the first time. It is known to Gauss. So that is something interesting. So don't think that Cauchy theorem is found by Cauchy, but it was known to people before that also. But then it was rediscovered by Cauchy and also V.S. Strass. So both found the Cauchy theorem, but somehow Cauchy wrote the book and then Cauchy's name is associated with it. But Cauchy developed the complex analysis in all detail. So here is a picture of Cauchy, a stamp in honor of him. That stamp indicates the Cauchy integral formula. And then there is a book written by Cauchy. The Cauchy's book is known as Cauchy D Analysis. So this book is now translated in English and is available for us. So you can see this is published by Springer. So you can see that original book of Cauchy now. So Cauchy initiated the complex function theory, and all that happened after that, we know what it is. So let us quickly wind up. There are other things that you may be seeing. The statement that Cauchy constructed the set of complex number in 1847 as Rx over x square plus 1 as a polynomial ring. Let us quickly wind up with this history business. Let me spend few minutes on something that I found out recently. While I was teaching my son, I thought of solving a cubic equation. If one root is known, then how do you get the other two roots? That is the story now. So if you write a cubic equation like this, and if there are three roots alpha, beta, gamma, then we know that alpha plus beta plus gamma is given by minus d by a. The product is given by minus d by a. And if you know gamma, then what you can do is you can just take the gamma to the other side from these two equations. Then you will get alpha plus beta as minus b by a minus gamma, alpha beta as minus d by a gamma. So you can just take the known root to the other side, and then you will get a relation between the two other remaining roots. So you know the sum of the roots and product of the roots in terms of the known quantity a, b, c, d, and the gamma that is known. So then you can form a quadratic equation using these two roots alpha and beta. This is the quadratic equation. This is exactly what you will get by the long division when you divide this equation or cubic equation by x minus gamma. If you divide this equation by x minus gamma using the long division, the quotient will be exactly this quantity. So you just get it. But you don't need to do long division to get it. You just use the relation between the roots and the coefficient. Then you will get it. And you can use this to get the remaining two roots. That I have given an example, but you can try this example on your own. The same thing you can do with fourth degree equation. If two roots of the fourth degree is known, then you can use the same idea, because the sum of all the roots is given by this, the product of all the root is given by this. If two of them are known, you use that to write alt is alpha plus beta and alpha beta. You will be getting these two expression for alpha plus beta and alpha beta. Using this, you can construct this quadratic equation whose roots are alpha and beta. So again, like dividing this big expression by x minus gamma into x minus delta, you will be getting it directly. You don't need to do a long division to get this equation. With this, I think you can easily get the two other solutions. So that is an easy method, I guess. No need of long division anymore. With this, we are going to wind up the lecture, the story. If you want to see the book, here is a book wherein you will see more and more information. Nahin by the book by Nahin, An Imaginary Tale of Square Root of Minus 1. This book you can see, and then you will get more and more information than what we just mentioned. And also, if you want to have much more information, then there is a course offered by Oxford, and it is also available. So you can also look at that Oxford lecture. Okay. With this, we will say bye-bye. Thank you.